that Killua in his god mode flexing on the royal guard in biggest flexes of Anime 7. We've had Mario Leona flexing on a member of the Eye of the Midnight Sun, completely annihilating him with Kaleidus Brachium in biggest flexes of Anime 9. Number 7 were the biggest flexes of lightning users in anime. Number 9 was the biggest flexes of fire users in anime. Welcome to the coolest episode of the biggest flexes in anime. Number 11, talking about the greatest ice flexes in anime, following the theme that we've been going by. On the last one, I asked for 80,000 likes, and well, you barely made it, okay? Barely. So, since you failed to get 80,000 likes the time before, I don't think you've passed that hurdle. So this video is definitely promised to you guys, so here it is. And if you don't slap 80,000 likes on it, the next one may not be out within a week, and it may be longer. So, smash that like button, feel free to subscribe, and let's get into the meat and potatoes of the biggest flexes in anime, number 11, Ice Flex Edition. First flex, Aokiji from One Piece. Obviously, we're starting with Aokiji from One Piece. So in One Piece, people sail the seas in these massive ships. Some ships are very goddamn big, other ships are even bigger. Only two people travel alone. Hawkeye Mihawk travels on this tiny little rowboat thing, just sails around randomly, and well, we already covered him in biggest flexes 1. Aokiji, on the other hand, well, this mad lad uses a bicycle! Yes, he contains the ice devil fruit and freezes this really teeny path of ice for his bicycle wheels to traverse upon, and he sails the seas by just, like, biking across them. This guy's an absolute mad lad, and if I would see a guy biking across the ocean, I would wet myself as well. To give you a slight glimpse of this guy's tremendous power, when Whitebeard attacks Marineford and he, like, uses his quake fruit to cause an entire tsunami, Aokiji, without even, like, blinking twice, freezes the entire massive tidal waves. Devil fruit users are immune to salt water, right? Not only does this guy freeze the tidal waves, but also he's not afraid of falling into the water. The guy just, like, bikes across the seas. I can't get over that. Now, Aokiji's a very interesting fella. We don't know exactly what he's doing right now, and he is definitely a man of mystery as far as One Piece goes. For this reason, he's one of my favorite characters. Mystery is great in One Piece. And when I say one of my favorite characters, I don't mean, like, top five. I mean, like, up there. I guess Sakazuki gets some credit for this as well. But when Aokiji was duking it out with Sakazuki, who's gonna become the next head admiral, they went to a private island because, well, they're mad would have devastated anywhere that they actually fought in, so I guess this was a good move. He was up against a magma devil fruit user. Akainu is really powerful, and in case you haven't played Pokemon, fire type is super effective against ice type. Even though that was the case, this battle lasted 3 days and 3 nights. Yes, Aokiji ended up losing the fight, but that doesn't mean the flex does not stand. The entire island of Punk Hazard became a freak of nature. Half of it, molten trenches of lava, and the other half, a wicked blizzard. This isn't just, they froze the ground and it melted a few days later. No. They goddamn changed the weather conditions of the island, and we saw the island over 2 years after their squabble. That is a flex on nature. Speaking of Punk Hazard and Aokiji, he was actually seen there. Now, I think that this flex goes a little bit unnoticed. Personally, I don't like that people just scoff at this moment, but Doflamingo is a really powerful dude. I mean, we saw his birdcage shiz. We saw him slice people to bits and control people like marionettes. And after Luffy and Law ravaged Punk Hazard and beat Caesar, Doflamingo head there personally because, well, Law was just flexing on Dofy hard, and Doflamingo finds Smoker. Doflamingo is far stronger than Smoker. Smoker at this point is a vice admiral. He's a powerful dude, but gets completely decimated by a warlord like Doflamingo. Doflamingo's on top of him, about to completely shred him, and in an instant, he gets flash frozen. Aokiji, the guy that we don't know where he's doing, what he's doing, is somehow there at the right time saying, "Yo, get your filthy butt off Smoker." Didn't say it in those words, it would have definitely made it cooler, but Doflamingo knows that one false move and he would have turned into a bunch of ice cubes. The flex of Aokiji was that without even uttering a word, by just walking behind Dofy, Dofy knew he had absolutely no chance of survival, and the very prideful, let me remind you, Doflamingo walked away without claiming any prize or consolation for his loss in Punk Hazard. The fact that Aokiji dropped his position as an admiral of the Marines to just go about doing whatever the hell he's doing is amazing. It is a huge flex saying that I don't agree with your rule, Sakazuki, and I'm not afraid to just walk away. So now I talked about Aokiji for a while, but I could talk about my favorite flex of the mad lads. Luffy is a guy that doesn't get bodied easily. Throughout the series, any opponent that he actually faces, he does sort of put up a fight against them. That is, until Wano. But a lot of people, even though they say that, "Oh wow, look how powerful Kaido is," no one actually bodies Luffy throughout the series. Kaido's so strong! Yeah, they say say that last part too. I didn't add it for emphasis. That is actually how those people sound. They all forgot about Aokiji! The entire Straw Hat crew meet Aokiji on an island. Now, let me remind you, they're pirates, and Aokiji is a marine admiral. But he's like, nah, I don't feel like capturing you guys. And he boringly and slowly flash freezes the strongest fighters of the Straw Hats in an instant. He can literally poke them on the head and they'll tip over and shatter into a million pieces. This is Luffy we're talking about. The up-and-coming pirate that's taking down warlords and is now known as an emperor, almost. He was beaten by Aokiji with less than a blink worth of effort on Aokiji's part. I think this is a massive flex on the entire series. And by the fact that no one mentions it, it just blows my mind that everyone's going nuts about the fact that Kaido wiped out Luffy in one hit. If that's impressive to you, but Aokiji doing it earlier is forgettable. I don't know what you're talking about, but Aokiji is a massive flexer, and I'm really happy to have started with him. Next flex! Haku from Naruto. So, we went from talking about Aokiji, an admiral, like an endgame One Piece character, and we're kind of switching all the way over to early Naruto. Haku, who doesn't even show up after episode 20 aside from that whole revival shiest.
We won't talk about that.
Haku's definitely an ice user. That ice mirror thingo technique is actually really powerful. Haku even had a light speed feat, reflecting from one mirror to the other, annihilating Naruto and Sasuke. Now, annihilating Naruto and Sasuke is not exactly, you know, a massive flex. They were kind of Genin at the time, and it's less impressive because then you realize, hey, wait a second, if Haku, instead of would be holding a bunch of pressure point needles, would just be holding one kunai, damn, he could have just thrown it and killed them instantly. Yeah, but we're not gonna talk about that. The flex I wanted to talk about in regards to Haku is the fact that Haku is prettier than Sakura, and that is canon. Suck it, Sakura fans. I'm sorry, that's not the Haku flex I wanted to talk about. And also, sorry again for making up an entire fan base. There are no Sakura fans. Take that, Sakura fans that don't exist. Yeah, my arguments make sense. In any case, Haku has this thingo that he can make hand signs with one hand. Like, all the ninjas walking around, they're making like billions of hand signs, and of course they use two hands because, well, of course you have to use two hands. Then Haku comes along and's like, nah fam, this ain't it, chief, and uses one hand to make ice jutsu. In all, it's a big flex because Kakashi, the copy ninja, who copied 1,000 jutsu and who's copying all of Zabuza's, can't copy Haku with this legendary Sharingan thing. I don't know. I personally found that pretty cool. Then, of course, that entire massive flex is retconned later on by the fact that no ninjas seem to use hand signs, and I stand by that. But at the time, it was a pretty cool flex because it grows the entire world of Naruto to an extent. We think we kind of know what's going on with jutsus, and then they're like, nah, fam, this ain't it, chief! Sorry, I just like putting those two together when we're talking about Naruto hand signs. And I'm also really excited about that latest chapter of Boruto where it was like, oh my god, the one-handed hand signs? Yeah, that was Hashirama cells all along. Next flex! Dio from JoJo's Bizarre Adventure. So first, you're probably wondering, why next? You already talked about Dio in Biggest Flexes in Anime Part 2! And the answer to that question is yes. But this time, I'm looking at it from an ice power reference, and I'm not gonna be talking about the infinite flexes he does throughout, because, again, I've done that in Part 2, remember? One thing Araki is really good at, it's forgetting, or at least making believe he forgets. There's a whole meme about how, oh, Araki, the creator of JoJo's, for those of you who did not know, forgot that Dio had ice powers, and then in Part 3, he never used them. Araki doesn't forget Jack. This mad lad makes believe he has a bad memory, so he can't call him out on stuff that, oh, he forgot. He feels like every time he reads his own manga, it's like he's reading it for the first time. You're calling this genius that's in the middle of Part 8 of an extremely successful manga series a guy who just forgets whatever goes on despite the infinite memes that are floating around about literally every scene? I think not. I think that the Araki forgot meme is fabricated by him as part of his master plan to lull us into a false sense of security when in actuality he remembers everything. The man wrapped up Fugo's character arc in Part 5, and that's why he didn't reintroduce him. It would have been detrimental to the story to reintroduce him, so oop, he forgot what to do with him! Kakyoin uses this ridiculous paint thingo attack against Jotaro, as well as that body possession thing in episode 2 of JoJo's Part 3, and then when he joins the good guys, he never uses it again! Oop! Araki forgot! Or it would have made the series stupid! That's right, Araki forgetting is a stroke of genius. In fact, he is flexing his 5,000 IQ on us at all time. But in the Dio case, he absolutely did not forget that Dio had ice powers. I mean, it's like the majority of Part 1. This guy not using ice powers in Part 3 is to flex. That is correct.
The world
though is so powerful.
He doesn't even have the need to use ice powers because he doesn't need to freeze his opponent.
No.
He can freeze time. In this really weird time freeze imabob, where somehow he can still throw knives and they move and then stop somehow, and where his opponent is somehow conscious and can choose which 2 seconds of Dio's 5 seconds of frozen time he can move. Obviously, this isn't stopping time in the general sense. It's the JoJo's Bizarre Adventure version of stopping time, meaning it's way more awesome.
That's right, I said it.
But I think Dio's biggest actual ice flex, as opposed to just stopping time, which, well, he freezes time, to be taken very literally, is when he's up against Sturetsu in JoJo's Part 1. Sturetsu uses Hamon. Hamon fire-based. Again, for those of you who've played Pokemon, fire-type is super effective on ice-type. So, when Sturetsu uses his Thunder Cross Split attack against Dio, he remembers to remind the people around him, as well as the audience at home, that Thunder Cross Split is an attack that no one has ever been able to defend against. No man can survive Thunder Cross Split. And then Dio catches his flaming legs and then just like freezes Sturetsu and shatters him like an absolute mad lad. So technically, Dio's ice powers managed to flex on the sun-based Hamon power of Thunder Cross Split. And allow me to remind you that that is an attack that no man can survive. I understand that this is sort of a meme answer. Sort of a meme flex. I definitely get that. And while I do think it definitely is respectable, I wanted to talk about how Dio flexes his insane amount of powers on literally everyone. In Part 3, we're like, oh, this guy only can regenerate and is super strong and can fly and can teleport and has ice powers and has laser eyes and can control his internal organs, allowing them to, like, grab people with his intestines and whatever. And he can take control of someone else's body to survive. And he's immortal. And. This guy has a lot of powers in Part 1. He keeps him, moves on to Part 3, gains the stand known as the world.
Wow, that sounded so wrong.
Gains super strength. He can now fly in a different way, and he could freeze time. Yeah, this guy has a lot of powers and he flexes all of them. Just saying, I think it's very cool. Now, I'm about to talk about a next pseudo flex because I don't know if I should really count it as a separate one, talking about Esteth from Akame ga Kill. So now, Esteth has ice powers as well. In fact, that's her power in Akame ga Kill. She's extremely strong. She freezes entire enemy armies that invade her homeland, kind of for the fun of it, and she falls in love with the main character because, well, he's the main character, duh. I wanted to talk about Dio's massive ice flexes, and I'm gonna do that here. JoJo references transcend literally everything. Yes?
Yes.
Dio, who has ice powers, eventually gains the ability to freeze time in Part 3. Yes? Well, this transcends to Akame ga Kill because Esteth's ultimate ice powers, she can freeze time. Tell me that's not copying JoJo's. Tell me Dio did not transcend to Akame ga Kill. Yes, this is a pseudo flex because it's still part of Dio's ice flex. God damn it. Thanks for listening to this mini rant about how Araki doesn't forget. And yes, I found another way to talk about Dio. I'm epic. I know. Moving on. Next flex. Isaac McDougal from Furumetsu to Arukumisu Purezehudo. And he has ice powers. And, like, he melts ice to turn into water to rain on Mustang. So then Mustang can't use his flint gloves and make fire. And he doesn't even kill Mustang. He just said, ha, you're useless on rainy days. Massive flex there, Isaac McDougal. Extremely cool. And if you think that that is just a total cop-out of a flex, even though I think it was a flex, have in mind, I probably included Isaac McDougal on the list just to say Furumetsu to Arukumisu Purezehudo. That may have been my ulterior motive, but let's not think too hard into them. In worst case, you can just count Esteth as a flex if you don't like this one. Next flex! In a little-known anime called Bleach, there is a little-known captain named Toshiro Hitsugaya. This mad lad flexes on everyone because he's a captain at like the age of 10 or something. I mean, all these captains are like thousands of years old or whatever, and then this 10-year-old schnook comes along and he's like, yeah, bitch, I'm a captain level 2. Now, while it's clear enough to understand that his very being a captain is a huge flex on all these other Soul Reapers that are working their ass offs to become like, I don't know, lieutenants and shiz, mad respect fam. But it's his other flexes in the series that truly allows him to enter the biggest flexes in Anime 11 Ice Edition. His sword, Hyurin Maru, is extremely cool. And his Bankai Daiguren Hyurin Maru is, well, goddamn freezing. It's funny that the impression I get for Hitsugaya among the Bleach fans is either you love him or you're very, very neutral about him. My friend Clyde, huge Bleach fan. I mean, literally every time I talk about Bleach, I'm like, oh damn, wonder what Clyde's up to. That's how much of a Bleach fan the guy is. This one's for you, Clyde. But Clyde doesn't like Hitsugaya, and that hurts because I freaking love him. And if I like a Bleach character that Clyde doesn't, then he's either a psychopath or a massive flexer. So Hitsugaya goes into the massive flexer category. If you like bleaches, I will link Clyde in the description, by the way. The guy freaking stands it, and he has my respect for it. Hitsugaya has two flexes in particular that I would like to talk about. And no, neither of them are the time that he fought Espada Numero Tres, because both these flexes are bigger. First, he's fighting one of the early Arrancars, and as you know, whenever some new villainous force is introduced, oh my god, they're so crazy powerful with the ability beginners look. The first time they are introduced, they are far more powerful than any future time. So this was in the beginner's look stage, where the Arrancars were flexing all the Soul Reapers to show their immense power and why they are going to be impossible to defeat. So one of them has the misfortune to run into Hitsugaya, and they get into this big aerial battle. It's a hell of a lot of fun. I always like Hitsugaya fighting because he has a really nice stoic expression on his face as he annihilates his opponent. There are many qualities in Hitsugaya that makes me love his character, and one is the fact that it's clear that based on his lack of experience in battle and in life, his sense of justice is very pure throughout. The first of the two flexes I'm going to be talking about is when he administers said justice beautifully, and the second is when he flexes even though justice does not demand it. Arrancar guy is flexing on Hitsugaya saying, yo bro, you can freeze shiz, big whoop dog, there ain't no water around here for you to freeze, and Hitsugaya just shrugs him off and says, no water for me to freeze? You seem to be mistaken, my friend, because there is far more water than you realize. I could freeze all the moisture in the atmosphere, and he freezes the water particles in the air itself and compresses it to crush his Arrancar foe. Yes, this guy literally freezes the sky to take the fat W. Was it a complete necessity in this fight? Definitely not. Did it feel hella dope? Definitely yes. And the second flex I wanted to talk about is from one of my favorite filler episodes in all of anime. It's when, right after the really awesome, by the way, Soul Society arc, many of the Shinigami went to the human world to just kind of dick around a lot. I mean, I'm pretty sure that was the plot, and it was glorious. That filler arc is phenomenal. It's basically an isekai comedy show within the genius of Bleach. Or, well, a reverse isekai, since it's the other world dudes coming into the normal one and trying to integrate. It's amazing! I love this filler arc, and my favorite episode from this arc involves Karin, Ichigo's little sister, who is, by the way, even more badass than Ichigo himself, and I stan Karin and her very cool relationship with Hitsugaya, and I ship them together because, like, they're both 10, so, like, whoopee, we could definitely do this and it's not at all weird. Hitsugaya is a captain of the Soul Society. This guy is a freaking boss mad lad dude. Karin and her team wanted to play soccer, and there were some, like, big bullyish kids saying, nah, bro, we got the court now! Man, do I relate to that. And Hitsugaya, as I've mentioned, throws his sense of justice out the window. This is not the task he's here to perform, but it doesn't matter because it's not only about duty, it's about what he feels is just in any given situation. So he goes and plays soccer on Karin's team, completely annihilating the dude bros that tried to kick them off the court. I mean, let's be real here. The captains in the Soul Society all have light speed feats, essentially. Beating these guys in soccer is like a hassle at most, and it's only a hassle because it'll take a few minutes. Not that they actually pose any threat. This dude just cruises through the field with the presence of the entire generation of miracles from Kuroko no Basket and annihilates them, and he does it purely to flex on them, scaring them away from the field so Karin could play soccer. I love this flex. I'm sorry. Hitsugaya is a mad lad, and filler can be great. The filler in this case actually enhanced Hitsugaya's character for the entire show and gave us more of Karin, which is also extremely cool. Not to mention, it was very funny. Filler is not inherently bad. It just unfortunately uses its powers for the forces of darkness far too often.
Next!
In the Pokemon Adventures manga, which I guarantee you I will never stop recommending, it's amazing no one reads it because they think, oh, Pokemon, it's just kids and shiz. No! The Pokemon Adventures manga is goddamn beautiful. I say it so often, it's almost like a broken record already. But you guys don't listen, so, like, what can I do? I have no choice. You know, for the good of humanity and stuff, I have to talk about, Giovanni! One of my favorite villains in all of anime or manga! This mad lad's first introduction in the story is when he walks up to Red. He hears that Red's quite the beast. He's taken down a ton of Team Rocket members, foiled a ton of their plans. Giovanni wants to meet him with his own eyes so he can assess the threat Red poses. So, Giovanni orchestrates a little test. He ensures that he is attacked by two Magmars. And when Red sees this, Red of course steps in to save him. He beats up the Magmars without injuring them too harshly so that they don't hurt anyone. He then saves Giovanni, who he does not know is Giovanni. Giovanni assesses that he is too soft to be too big of a threat for Team Rocket, and it is not worth worth taking him down here and now. Giovanni is a absolute mastermind, a brilliantly crafted character, and the daddy of the Pokemon Adventures manga! His first introduction is where even the fans do not realize he is the leader of Team Rocket. Only after Red saves him and he assesses that Red is not a threat, he then turns to the two incompetent Magmars and freezes them with a cloister until they are blocks of ice. Let me remind you, Magmars have the ability Flame Body. They are literally magma balls, and he freezes them and then shatters them to a million pieces, killing the two Magmars. He does this in a flash, purely because of their incompetence, and there is no further use to these Pokemon. His entire introduction was a massive flex on Red, deeming Red not even worthy of disposing of because he is too soft to be too viable of a threat. It is an absolute boss introduction for the absolute boss of Pokemon. The Pokemon Adventures manga is not just a kid with a Pikachu losing to level 5 Snivies, goddammit! It's actually great. The story's amazing, the characters are wonderful, and it is a bloodbath. In case you couldn't tell by where I was going with this, I do suggest reading it. Giovanni is a massive flexer, and freezing two balls of magmas to death is just extremely cool and definitely a nice flex. Next flex! We all know Gray from Fairy Tail has his epic moments. In a series that's over 350 episodes long, where the cast and the cast's badass moments makes up most of the great moments in the series, obviously Gray, one of the main characters, is gonna have some massive flexes. And he does. Gray, like everyone else in Fairy Tail, is a weirdo. The dude, for no reason at all, decides to get naked at all times because, well, I don't know, he doesn't even know himself why he gets naked at all times. He doesn't even do it consciously. That's how cool he is. So now, since Fairy Tail is long, as I've mentioned, I am only gonna briefly talk about several of Gray's epic ice flexes. When he fought against Juvia in the Phantom Lord arc, he was so badass of a flexer against Juvia, she fell in love with him so hard, she became a massive Yandere chasing him for the rest of the series. Now that is a massive flex! I don't want to hear otherwise. When Gray was against his dad that was revived as a demon, he learnt and unlocked Demon Slayer magic to defeat him and proceeded to fight against Marred Gear, the leader of Tartaros. And well, don't catch me wrong! That's not nearly as big of a flex as his other Demon Slayer flexes! No, no, no! His other Demon Slayer flex is when he made believe that the Demon Slayer magic took over his body and he could not control it, because as everyone knows, Demon Slayer magic is incredibly unstable and unfortunately it could take over people's minds. So he goes total nutso in the beginning of Fairy Tail's final season. He allies up with bad guys and it turns out he was a double agent all along. Of course he has full control over the Demon Slayer magic. How else is he gonna slay the ultimate demons? Duh! He fools everyone, friend and foe alike. And while he infiltrates the enemies, not only does he beat a ton of them, not only does he get critical information, not only is he such a mad lad, he completely fools the Magic Council, Natsu's group, and of course, well, the people he joins, but he also picks up Lost Magic, a magic that he threatens to use against Zeref, you know, the ultimate unkillable wizard of death master dude, the incredibly powerful and ridiculous guy that was hyped up for the entire series. A single Lost Ice Shell from Gray would have completely annihilated Zeref. He was threatening to wipe his own memories out of the minds of everyone, essentially removing his own existence from the world, purely to annihilate Zeref forever, and Zeref knew that he was toast. Zeref was terrified at that moment. It's only because Natsu was like, no, bro, I got this, fam. This ain't it, chief, that Gray stood down. Gray's Lost Ice Shell was actually gonna beat Zeref. Invel is this ice wizard that was one of Zeref's top dudes. This ice wizard was so broken, he froze people by just being in his proximity. He can make it snow over an entire country and freeze whatever the snowflakes touches. He has this ice necklace thingy that can, like, mind control people. Invel is pretty damn broken, is what I'm trying to say. Fairy Tail's greatest height is the emotional moments between the characters, even more so than the big flexes. So, you'll understand when I say that this flex really hits hard. Invel puts one of those mind control collar thingos around Gray and Juvia, who both love each other, and tells them to kill each other, where the strongest of them will then have a chance to survive. Of course, Invel was lying, planning to kill both of them, but he wanted to see them suffer a little bit more. In fact, he thought that if Gray would kill Juvia, his Demon Slayer powers would actually take him over and he would join their side. So, of course, without hesitation, both Gray and Juvia immediately kill themselves. Well, it's Fairy Tail, so not exactly kill themselves, but it sort of looks that way. Juvia uses a water technique to give her own blood as a transfusion to Gray to keep him alive, and then later she ends up getting saved because Wendy happened to be in the right place at the right time, and it's Fairy Tail. Point is, that moment was emotionally balls! Both characters in a heartbeat just killing themselves when they heard that they had to kill each other? That's unbelievable. And when Gray saw Juvia essentially die, administering the last of her magic as a transfusion to save Gray, Gray went berserk. He didn't need no Demon Slayer magic. No, 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 no. No matter what badass spells Invel was pulling out of his ass, Gray completely obliterated him with the most basic of ice techniques. He flexed on him so hard, Invel was left a shattered man. I love Fairy Tail very much. I know that it's kind of a controversial thing to say because a lot of people say, oh, Fairy Tail is garbage, it's just bad shonen. And I am considering very seriously making a video attesting to the exact opposite of that. With Fairy Tail ending, I only have good things to say about it, despite the fact that it has a myriad of issues, because I genuinely love a lot of what this series did. I'm running through big gray flexes, and every character in Fairy Tail has big moments like these. Fairy Tail really has heart, and that's why I'm looking forward to doing an overall video on the entire thing. I'm sorry, I know that maybe I'm the only one that feels this way about Fairy Tail, but I do, and I try to be honest, even though, well, I'm a sarcastic, annoying bastard sometimes, and I understand that as well. My greatest qualities are pretty much being self-aware that I'm an annoying bastard. Hell yeah! And that's why I'm gonna leave you with my favorite gray flex in the entire Fairy Tail series, and it is in the Grand Magic Games, my personal favorite arc. The arc is met with a lot of criticism, and well, I will dispel that in my Fairy Tail video, but Gray is up against Rufus. Rufus is a bit of a beast. He's one of the Sabretooth members, and everyone in Sabretooth is A, really strong, B, was trying to flex on Fairy Tail for Fairy Tail sucking for the last 7 years because of a time skip. Don't ask questions! In fact, in the first round of the Grand Magic Games, Rufus flexed on Gray himself, because it turns out while Gray uses ice make magic, where he can make anything out of ice, like daggers or blades or whatever the hell he decides to do, Invel has memory make magic. He can create anything that he's ever seen before, which obviously encompasses a far larger range and is way more broken than ice make magic. So when he goes up against Gray one-on-one in the grand finale of the Grand Magic Games, you know this shiz is gonna be grand, and Gray comes out on top. Top dog Gray kicks his butt! That feathery, flamboyant piece of garbage! Because whatever Rufus tried to make out of memory, Gray just copied his memories out of ice and made it even bigger and more flamboyant! Oh, you're making this massive wheel of blades that you've seen that one time? I don't mind. I'll make the same massive wheel of blades, just even massiver, but out of ice! That is how you flex on a flexer, my boy! Mad respect to Gray, and thank you, Fairy Tail, for being with me for many years. Despite the hate, I appreciate you. Fairy Tail may have ended, but it will always remain in our hearts. Next flex! You know Digimon, the kids show that happens to be the best isekai anime of all time? Well, in OG Digimon Adventure 1, there was this Chad called Metal Garurumon. Tai and Matt are two opposing forces in the Digimon series. Yes, a show for kids with two main characters that both have character development that definitely outclass the majority of adult series. Sorry, just gonna drop that here. Tai was selected to be the leader of the group because of his more brave, out-of-the-box approach, and Matt is a de facto second-in-command who often questions Tai's judgment because he is far more logical and cautious. The dynamic between these two, aside from making up a very solid main and second-to-main character, make a great dynamic rivalry between them as well. The two of them evolve at a pretty much equivalent pace, where the first two mega-level Digimon to be introduced to the protagonist side of the Force were that of Tai and Matt when they were up against literal Satan. I mean, this dude is a Digimon! You know, he's made of zeros and ones, and he managed to find a way to attack the human world. Some people know him as Myotismon, and others, more cultured intellectuals, know him as Metrosexual Vampiremon. After this mad lad goes mega, there's this whole prophecy that's gonna defeat him at the 6th hour of the 6th minute of the 6th second of whatever, 666 stuff, basically Satan taking over the world. Sucks balls, right? Right. Matt and Tai both get their Digimon to digivolve to mega levels for the first time, entering War Greymon, the mad lad that can hurl a miniature sun at his opponents, and Metal Garurumon, the master of ice. They manage to take down interdimensional metrosexual Satan, restore balance to the Force, and then immediately head back to the digital world in order to save that world as well. Basically, Digimon is epic and dope and stuff, definitely the best isekai anime. I don't even want to hear about it from these haters. But in my opinion, the biggest flex on Metal Garurumon's side is when they were up against the four Dark Masters, four mega-level Digimon that took over the digital world while the Digidestined were away to save the human world, and when they're up against them, there's a little rift. Tai and Matt do not exactly see eye to eye in certain things, and Matt leaves the group. Take notes, modern shonen! You could learn something! It's a pure battle of ideology between them that causes Matt to leave. Not that they per se want to kill each other or anything, no! They just kinda hate each other for the way they're going about it. Tai says Matt's a coward, and Matt says Tai is endangering them for no reason. Anywho, Puppetmon is one of the four Dark Masters, and Tai and his squad really want to take him down! He's basically one of the four tyrants that are killing out all these Digimon. Very, very big sad. They actually put Puppetmon through the ringer a bit. They put him through a really solid fight. They take down a lot of his subordinates. They mess up his entire wacky house. Honestly, the Puppetman arc in the Dark Master arc was very solid. And eventually, Puppetmon actually manages to escape. He gets away from Tai's group, and they don't know where he went. But Matt, the absolute mad lad with his Metal Garurumon, knew that's what Tai was going for, so they blocked off the escape route. As Puppetmon crawls away, he bumps into a very icy death. Matt essentially flexed on Tai's entire group, where Tai was saying this is the only way to go about it, and Matt literally uses Tai's entire strategy to take down Puppetmon with his own hand in a way that Tai would have failed to do so. Massive flex, brilliant character writing, best isekai anime of all time. Next flex! And it's from my boy, Todoroki Shoto from My Hero Academia. As much crap as you want to give literally anyone in the vicinity, whether you're like Lord Brigo and you think it's your purpose in life to hate on Todoroki, or whether you think you're cultured enough to not enjoy My Hero Academia even though it's like legitimately a good enjoyable series. There's no reason to hate the show just because it's popular. Todoroki has some epic flexes in season uno and dos of My Hero Academia. Denying that would be a lie equivalent to saying, I don't know why that anime's girl's eyes are rolled up and her tongue is sticking out. That makes no sense. Yeah, that's how dumb you sound. The guy's first introduction in the series was in the little training episode in like episode 7 or whatever, the first season, and where every squad got into like this massive squabble between them where eventually one would win. And I don't even need to explain to you the rules of this game. Todoroki freezes the entire building, and that's the moment where you shut your trap and watch this master flexer at work. Even in the tournament arc itself, they introduce those massive robots that they've already mentioned. You should run away if you see them. And he just swats it aside with ice like it's not even a challenge for him at all. And to be fair, it wasn't. I think the biggest flex on a physical level, not a psychological level, we'll get to psychological flexes in a moment, is when he's up against Seto, otherwise known as Tape Guy. You know, R-word Spider-Man. The poor lad who can never wear long-sleeved clothes or it completely annihilates his quirk's abilities. You know, that guy! The guy that actually thought he had a chance against Todoroki is like, well, Todoroki, if I slap him with tape really fast and hurl him out of the rink, I have a chance. And Todoroki's like, well, I could kill you with a literal popsicle, but instead I'm gonna make a massive glacier freeze the crap out of your genitalia. So not only will the excessive amount of ice be popping out of the top of the arena for literally no reason other than to flex on you, but also your balls will be so numb you won't get a hard-on for a month. Legends say that is exactly what occurred to poor Seto. I personally love Todoroki. He's definitely in my 5 favorite characters of My Hero Academia, and his flexes, well, they don't exactly detract from that fact. I think his biggest flex in the series, though, hands down, whether you like him for this or not, the flex is there. He has ridiculously powerful ice powers, and he also has ridiculously powerful fire powers, but literally to flex on his dad, he only uses his ice powers. That is a huge ice flex. Whether you want to say, well, if Todoroki really wanted to stick it to his dad, instead of becoming a hero that only uses ice powers, he could have become an accountant. And while I completely understand that statement, and in fact, I've even said it on several occasions in the past, Todoroki wanted to become a hero. He didn't want to just make his dad disappointed in him. He wanted to one-up his dad and surpass him, but he wanted to flex on him by only using ice, not his father's flame. Personally, I see that as a massive flex on a psychological level. And even though he grew past that petty flex, the flex was there, and it was huge. Literally wiping the floor with his contemporaries with just half his power, not to mention added bonus of flexing on Pop. The flex was huge, the flex was there, and I'm really excited for My Hero Academia Season 4, even though Todoroki's basically not even in it, unfortunately. Thank you so much for watching this video. I hope you did enjoy it. Feel free to smash like. 80,000 likes and biggest flexes in Anime 12 will be out within a week. Just destroy that like button, goddammit. You don't lose anything. You just gain more flexes. It's a win-win. Also, feel free to subscribe to know when that comes out. Links in the description are to my Twitter, to my Patreon, to my merch, and to my Twitch. Feel free to check all those out. That would be very awesome and appreciated. Let me know some of your favorite anime flexes in the comments below so I could include them in future videos. Not like I'm running out of flexes or anything, backers. Have yourselves a most wonderful evening, and remember to stay weird, fam.